Well, it's a race that will go down in the history books. It was a very tough battle and a very close race, we think. And I'd like you to meet our next brand new governor, Kay Orr. Kay, congratulations.
Thank you, Lita.
You must be exhausted. Have you had any sleep at all?
Oh, yes, about 3 hours. But as people have said to me in the waning days of the campaign, aren't you tired? And I said, I'll be tired the day after tomorrow when I go on vacation.
When it all runs out. Let me ask you a question. A lot of money was spent. I mean, over $1 million on both sides. Is there a better way to do it? I'm thinking about those people who can't raise the million-plus dollars necessary. And so, therefore, we eliminate some of the kinds of people who might be potentially fine candidates. Is there a better way to do it?
No, I don't think so, because it's a voluntary contribution that's made. It's an investment. And if you start limiting, then you limit it perhaps to people who have personal wealth. If people don't have the ability to attract people with their ideas and the issues and what they stand for, and attract that money, they're not going to be a viable candidate anyway. So it's something that some may have to work a little longer to build up that network of support, but I think it's a good system. And as expensive as it may be, as I mentioned earlier, it's an investment. It's less money we spend on many other things that we do in this society.
Kay, in the last part of the campaign, there was some mudslinging between you and Helen. Whose idea was that? Was that the people who put together your campaign, or why did you feel the need to do
that? Well, there's been a great deal of talk, that word has been used, quote, mudslinging. But I think there has to be a closer examination of the message. What I talked about in my campaign, of course, were the issues that were facing Nebraskans, some of the problems that we face, and what I felt would be the solutions. In addition to that, I always talked factually, and I only talked about public statements that were made by my opponent and held them up for examination to the public. So I don't think that you can really characterize this campaign as being one of mudslinging. Mm-hmm. Not at all.
Well, I think we thought that perhaps there were no burning issues, really burning issues that galvanized the voters, and that's why it came to a question of personalities.
Well, I think we clearly stood on many of the same issues, on the issues with similar outlooks, because we understood the concerns. We had priorities in education, doing something about our agricultural economy, wanting to capitalize on the assets that are here in Nebraska to move us forward. But there was a philosophical difference. Perhaps that was more difficult for us to communicate to the voters. Also, there's sometime an unrealistic expectation among the voters that there's going to be some message that's set out in neon lights that is going to be, you know, clearly the difference between two candidates. But I think that is an unrealistic expectation on their part.
How important was President Reagan's coming to Nebraska to you? Was that significant?
Well, that's difficult for me to assess as well. I think we'll let some of the political analysts do that. I'm clearly known as a supporter of the president and in his philosophy, and a loyalist to him. He's well regarded and respected in this state. Many, of course, try and point out, what about the farm issue? Well, the farm issue is one that is a product of Washington policy, both by the administration and Congress. And as I traveled across the state and talked to those in agriculture, they were looking more for changes that needed to be made instead of pointing to any elected official, president or members of Congress, to say, you know, they were wrong. They didn't want to hear a negative about that. They wanted to hear solutions.
Mm-hmm. Any key appointments to announce this morning?
Well, the very first one to be made is to appoint a chief of staff, and that man will be, that position will go to Hans Brisch, who's been with me these past few months in the campaign, having been served as assistant to President Loskins at the university.
Good. How important are newspapers coming out in favor of you? Like the Omaha World Herald supported you, the Lincoln Journal and Star supported Helen. Is that significant?
Well, I think it plays an important part, because it does say that I have support in communities across the state. It's not the only factor. There are just so many important parts of a successful campaign. Basically, the message that's delivered by the candidate, but I attribute most of my success to the fact that I was able to bring together 18,000 volunteers across the state who worked in their communities.
Hindsight is always 2020, of course,
yes.
Kay. Would you do anything differently than you did?
Oh, well, there were some things left undone. And when you work with a volunteer organization like this, it's not a perfect beast by any means. But we felt we put together a campaign and an organization unlike this state has ever seen, and we're just very, very proud. I am of every single one of them.
When are you going to go to sleep?
Oh, in a couple of days.
Are you going to take some time off now?
My husband and I will leave on Friday, and we'll be gone for a week. And then, of course, there's a big task ahead.
Oh, so. Yes, well-deserved rest. Kay Orr, congratulations. You've gone down in history. We're very proud of you.
We're proud of Nebraska.
Very, very proud. Coming up next, you're going to meet a political professor, and he's going to analyze the gubernatorial race. Please stay with us.